My name is Shlomo or Sally Angel, and I'm a professor of city planning at the Maron Institute of Urban Management at New York University. My lecture today is about urban density, and more specifically, the average population density of a city as a whole, ignoring the variations in density within it. One of the aims of my lecture is to increase density literacy. There are many different ways to define and measure urban density, and this can be quite confusing. I hope to remove some of this confusion. Urban density is a key policy metric because it is a measure of how large a footprint of a city with a given population will occupy, and it is a good proxy for how long its infrastructure lines will be or how far people will have to travel to get from place to place. One of the attractive things about urban density is that it is measurable. And as Lord Kelvin said, if we measure it, we know something about it. And if we can measure it, we can do something about it. Let us define urban density at the outset. Urban density is simply the ratio of the total population of the city and the total footprint the city occupies. We measure urban density in, say, persons per hectare, where a hectare is 1% of a square kilometer. Dhaka, the capital of Bangladesh, had an average of 372 persons per hectare in 2014. Minneapolis in the United States had an average of 10. Urban density in Dhaka was 37 times that of Minneapolis. But just knowing these facts does not tell us much. They hide more than they reveal. In what sense is Dhaka's density high? In what sense is Minneapolis's density low? The key insight we present here is in exposing the anatomy of density and showing that urban density can be factored into separate metrics that expose its internal structure. What do we mean by factoring? We can factor the number 12, for example, into two factors, 3 and 4, that when multiplied together yield 12. 3 and 4 are factors of 12, so are 6 and 2. In a similar manner, we can factor urban density into 2, 3, 4, and even 7 metrics. In doing so, we build a structure that incorporates and integrates most of the familiar density metrics used by urban planners. What we discovered and are able to report here is that the factors that constitute urban density are measurable as well. In fact, we measured them in a rigorous manner in 10 representative cities from different world regions, and we plan to measure them in a global sample of 200 cities. The results surprised us. The density of each of these 10 cities depended on quite different factors. We will get into that soon. Let me start by showing what it means to break urban density into factors. Factors then, when multiplied together, reconstitute urban density. Floor space occupancy on the left is the ratio of the population of a city and its total residential floor area. It is a measure of how many people occupy a unit of residential floor area. The more there are, the less floor area per person. It is a gross measure of how crowded dwelling units in the city are. Floor area density on the right is the ratio of the total residential floor area of the city and the total area of the city's urban footprint. It is a measure of the density of residential floor area in the city, or more generally, of how common it is to find residential floor area or residential floor space in the city. The more of it there is, the more people the city accommodates. You can see that when we multiply one by the other, floor area cancels out and we get people divided by the urban footprint, which is our definition of urban density. So by factoring urban density into two factors, we gain some insight about its anatomy. The more people per unit floor area, the higher the urban density. The more floor area per areal unit of the city's urban footprint, the higher the urban density. We can go further. We can also break down floor area density into two factors, thus decomposing urban density into three factors. The floor area ratio, the yellow box, is a common density metric. It's defined here as the ratio of the total residential floor area in the city and the total residential area of the city, net of streets and other land uses. The residential share, the blue box on the right, is the share of the city's urban footprint occupied by residential areas. Again, when we multiply the floor area ratio by residential share, the residential area in the city cancels out and we get floor area density. This means that we can represent urban density as a product of three factors: floor space occupancy, floor area ratio, and residential share. When we represent urban density as a product of three factors, we can think about it as a box in three-dimensional space, where floor space occupancy is its width, its x-axis, residential share is its length, its y-axis, and floor area ratio is its height, its z-axis. We obtained values for these three factors for 10 cities in different world regions: Dhaka, Hong Kong, Kinshasa, Bogota, Cairo, Baku, Madrid, Bangkok, Wuhan, and Minneapolis. The urban density boxes for these cities are shown here in gray in order of declining density from left to right. The colored cube on the top left represents the 10-city average value for each factor. We can now see that different cities get their urban densities from quite different factors. Dhaka, the city with the highest density in the group, gets its density from above average floor space occupancy and residential share, while its floor area ratio is below average. Hong Kong, the second highest urban density, gets its high density from its above average floor area ratio, even though it has low residential share. Kinshasa, the third highest urban density, gets its high density from its very high floor space occupancy. It is extremely overcrowded and above average residential share, but its floor area ratio is way below average. In fact, every city has a unique combination of factors that give it its urban density, and we cannot guess the value of these factors from information about urban density alone. We need to look at them and measure them one by one. And the anatomy of density can go even further. We can factor urban density into four factors. We do so by factoring floor area ratio into two factors: building height and plot coverage. Building height is the ratio of the residential floor area and the area of all the residential building footprints in the city. It is a measure of the average number of residential floors on a given residential building footprint. Plot coverage is the share of the residential area in the city that is covered by residential building footprints. Again, when we multiply them together, residential building footprints cancels out and we get floor area divided by residential area, which is the floor area ratio. We now know that urban density is a product of four factors: floor space occupancy, building height, plot coverage, and residential share. It increases when either one increases, other things being equal, and declines when either one declines. Finally, we can go even further. We can also decompose floor space occupancy into four factors as well. The first is dwelling unit occupancy, which measures the number of persons in an occupied dwelling unit. The second is the occupancy rate, which measures the share of the total number of dwelling units in the city that are occupied, i.e. not vacant. The third is dwelling unit packing, which measures the number of dwelling units in a hectare of residential living area. It is the reciprocal of the average size of a dwelling unit in the city. The fourth is floor plan efficiency, which measures the share of the floor area of residential buildings in the city that is devoted to living areas, net of common spaces. Again, when we multiply all four together, everything cancels out and we get floor space occupancy. This essentially means that we can represent urban density as a product of seven measurable factors: dwelling unit occupancy, the occupancy rate, dwelling unit packing, floor plan efficiency, building height, plot coverage, and residential share. We can now see that in order to densify a city, we must increase one or more of these factors while ensuring that others do not decline. This kind of analysis has useful policy implications. We can increase dwelling unit occupancy, for example, by increasing the number of people that occupy a single dwelling unit. In times of crisis, we can do so by forcing family to share dwelling units. Otherwise, we can encourage communal living and larger households, or we can encourage lowering dwelling unit size. We can increase the occupancy rate by removing barriers and incentives that keep a larger than necessary share of the housing stock vacant. We can do so by introducing a vacancy tax on empty units, by permitting the leasing of vacant homes, by overcoming the resistance of owners to rent vacant units, by discouraging the supply of units not in demand, and by reversing central city abandonment. We can increase dwelling unit packing by encouraging people to reduce their consumption of floor area per person and to refrain from increasing it as they become better off. We can do this by allowing the subdivision of dwelling units, by removing minimum size limits on apartments, by eliminating the lending bias against condos, by avoiding displacement through urban renewal, and by encouraging the residential mobility of older people. We can increase floor plan efficiency by removing barriers and incentives that lower the share of living areas in the total residential area under construction. We can do this by encouraging lightweight construction, by improving high-rise building design, and by reducing parking requirements. We can increase building height by revising regulatory barriers and incentives that prevent the increase of residential floor space with taller multi-story buildings. We can do that by relaxing building height restrictions, by allowing the addition of floors on existing roofs, by increasing access to construction finance, by increasing allowable floor area ratios, and by expanding zoning for multifamily dwellings. We can increase plot coverage by removing or redesigning regulations that limit the share of the area of residential plots that building footprints can occupy. We can do that by reducing minimum lot size for single-family homes, by relaxing setback regulations, by allowing multiple units on single-family plots, and by increasing allowable floor area ratios. Finally, we can increase residential share by increasing the share of residential and mixed-use areas in the city, thus limiting the loss of residential area to other land uses. We can do so by accelerating the conversion of commercial and industrial areas to residential land use, by encouraging mixed use, by avoiding mass evictions for urban highways, and by avoiding the overallocation of lands for industrial use. To conclude, we can decompose urban density into measurable factors that allow us to explore its anatomy. They allow us to understand how different cities acquire their density and to see that they acquire it in different ways, something we could not see by simply looking at variations in urban density. Decomposing urban density into its factors also allows us to design comprehensive urban densification strategies that look at all the possible ways to increase urban density in a systematic way. The anatomy of density thus provides urban planners and policymakers with a tool that allows them both to implement complex densification plans and to measure how increases in each of the factors contribute to progress in densification, now a key goal in our global urban agenda. Thank you.